start. So today we have Marco Chianese. He's finishing his PhD.
No, I'm second year.
Finishing. It's better than starting in Naples with the astroparticle group. We have here Gena Roniere that you probably know. He's so frequent that he's no longer a visitor, he's just a friend and collaborator. So Marco has also collaborated with people who were here in our group before, with Sofiane and with Stefano Morisi, and he will tell about that matter scenario.
So today I'm going to talk about the string experiment, and so the oscillation of high energy extraterrestrial neutrino, and I'm going to talk about the possible dark matter scenario that can display the full or part of the neutrino spectrum observed by SKIP. So the talk is divided into two parts. In the first part I will briefly describe the SKIP experiment, and so its observation. Then I will talk about the possible scenario that can explain the origin of high energy neutrinos, in particular the astrophysical scenarios and also the dark matter scenarios. And then I will focus on about a study that we made on a possible electrophilic, very heavy dark matter candidate, which is electrophilic dark matter, which can explain only the very high energy neutrinos, the perfect neutrinos. Then, if I have time, in the third part, I will discuss a possible excess in the low energy neutrino spectrum, and so the analysis and a study. I will discuss about a study that about the origin of such excess. So the first part, so S-cube is a very huge detector of a 1 kilometer cube figure cell volume. It is located in the South Pole, and it is able to detect neutrinos of energy starting from 1 TeV and up to 10 to 6 TeV, and it is a Cherenkov detector. In fact, when the neutrinos comes in the highest and interact with the highest nuclei, there is the production of charged particles that then produce Cherenkov light. And the detector observed the Cherenkov light, and the energy deposit is measured with a precision of 15%, so it's quite good energy precision. We have two different topology of the event. We have the track events, which are related to charged current eruption, mostly due to the muon neutrinos. And in this case, we have a S-cube had a good angular resolution of about 1 dB. On the other hand, we have also the shower topology, which are related to the charged current interaction and also to the nebula current interaction, which are mostly due to electron and tau neutrino. In this case, the angular resolution is not so good. In fact, it is about 15 degrees. So this is an event, a track event, with a neutrino with an energy deposit energy of 30 TeV. And so we can see that this is an upgoing event, and we can see that the angular resolution is quite good, but on the other hand, for the shower-like topology, we have a very bad precision on declination, and this is the event with the neutrino with having a deposit energy of 2 TeV. So we know that the ice cube experiment or the neutrino text experiment are dominated by the neutrino background, in particular at low energy of the order of 1 TeV up to few tens TeV. So the background is due to the interaction of cosmic ray with the atmosphere, and we have two different types of different kind of neutrino background. In particular, we have the conventional background, neutrino background, which are the neutrino which are produced by the decay of pions and tauons, and this kind of background dominates the observation at energy which are of the order of TeV. So with an increase of energy, this kind of neutrino are suppressed, because with an increase of energy, the lifetime of pions and counts increase, so they don't decay in neutrinos. But we have another kind of background, which are prompt neutrinos, which dominate at an energy of 50 TeV. And in this case, the interaction of cosmic ray with the proton of the atmosphere produces Charmian meson that then fastly decay in neutrinos. So we have answer to a question. So if the S-cube has detected terrestrial or extraterrestrial neutrino. But S-cube has also a mu beta. In fact, in this case, in all of these cases, so CO for the conventional for prompt neutrinos, we have that neutrinos are accompanied by a very high energetic muon. So S-cube has a muon beta region, and in particular if the so has a muon beta. So if the S-cube S-cube has a signal in muon region, which is due to a muon track, so the event is discarded, and also if the energy of neutrino is lower than 30 TeV. And this is true for downgoing events, so for neutrinos that comes from the atmosphere, in the South Pole, but on the other hand, for upgoing particles, the help is a filter. So in this plot, you can see the study of the conventional neutrinos, the expected signal from conventional neutrino for the conventional background, and also from prompt neutrinos. And as we can see, for a negative declination angle, so from downgoing events, we have suppression due to the muon beta. And on the other hand, for a positive angle, we have the suppression coming from the absorption of the Earth. And the black line is what we expect in case of astrophysical extraterrestrial neutrinos. So this slide summarizes the S-cube data after 3 years of taking data. So we can S-cube had observation of 57 events from energy of 1 TeV up to 2 PeV, so 10 to 3 TeV. We have the neutrino spectrum is mostly isotropic flux, and we are sure that we are observing an extraterrestrial neutrino, since there is a deviation from the atmospheric background, which is a muon and neutrino of about 5.7 sigma. Here there are the three highest neutrino events, which are the two neutrino events having a deposit energy of 1 PeV and then one event of 2 PeV. In this slide I summarized the S-cube data after 4 years of data taking. As you can see, we have observation as S-cube as the observation of 54 events. Again, the flux is mostly isotropic. Yes?
Just a stupid question. After December 2012, no other very high energy events was observed?
No, we have S-cube as the observation also of a neutrino with a deposit energy of 1.6 PeV, but this is neutrinos has a track like topology, and it is not fully contained, so the uncertainty on the primary neutrino energy is very large, because this kind of event is not fully contained in the detector, so the energy can be also as large as 10 PeV and so even more. So in the talk I do not consider this event for the following. And so we have with the latest data of S-cube, we have a deviation from the atmospheric background muons and neutrinos about 7 sigma.
Now the atmospheric neutrinos for you is a background, but in principle you could study them also at some level, or it's too little. I mean, you cannot do any study with the atmospheric neutrinos? Rough study?
I don't know if S-cube, maybe with Pingu, they have studied with the atmospheric neutrinos.
Because here is just too few.
Yes, there are too few. But I think that there are other experiments in the S-cube collaboration that have studied on
I meant upgrading somehow the that thing.
And actually, I mean, there are papers, I mean, using atmospheric muons, atmospheric neutrinos for oscillations and for just studying the flux. So
I'm just saying, something very rough, you could say, probably, even with very few.
Well, I mean, the results for instance for oscillations are not that bad. I mean, of course, you cannot compete with, you know, I mean, but I mean, they are, and for measuring, I mean, the neutrino spectrum, they are, I mean, the best results, I mean, for large range of energies.
So now a question is done. What is the origin of these high energy neutrinos? So this brings me to the second part of the talk. In this slide, I want to stress that we, in both the 3 years and 4 years high-scoop data, we have two important key features in the neutrino spectrum. We have a lack of data in the energy range between 300 TB up to 1 PB, and then we have a cutoff. If we do not consider the 2.6 neutrino event, we have a cutoff for energy above 2 PB. So, in some sense, we have to explain this kind of feature that we observe from the neutrino spectrum. So the neutrino high energy spectrum can be explained in most statistical scenario sources, which are, for instance, the extragalactic supernova remnants or gamma ray bursts, active galactic nuclei, and so on. This kind of scenarios, statistical scenarios, can be parameterized. I used to be parameterized as a power law or a broken power law, so they have a natural cutoff due to the parameter of the astrophysical scenarios, like the size of magnetic field or the spatial size of the sources. And in this kind of scenarios, the neutrinos are produced by hadronic interaction due to the cosmic ray. So we have two kinds of mechanisms for the production of neutrinos. One is the proton-proton interaction, and the other is the proton interaction with the gamma of the intergalactic space.
So why do we have this exponential follow?
Yes, because for instance in supernova remnants the highest energy, neutrino energy is due to the size of magnetic fields. So the magnetic field has an upper bound, so this lead to a natural cutoff on the energy spectrum of neutrinos. So the size of cutoff depends on the astrophysical scenario and the astrophysical source. So this is a paper due to Chakraborty and Zawir in which they try to explain the S-cube data, the 3-year S-cube data with the extragalactic supernova remnants and hypernova remnants. As we can see in this case, the extragalactic supernova remnants has a cutoff of the order of a few hundred TB. So this kind of sources can explain only the lowest part of the neutrino spectrum observed at S-cube. On the other hand, we have also the gamma ray burst. As we can see in this paper, these kind of sources are affected by large uncertainty in the production mechanism. And also, as we can see, so they can explain the S-cube data, but the spectrum can be smaller than 2 orders of magnitude with respect to the observer flux at the S-cube. And also, since in these sources neutrinos are produced by the interaction of proton and gammas, one would expect a correlation with the observation of gammas, and this kind of correlation is not observed yet. And also in the one paper by Tambor e Ando, we can see that the general mechanism of the production of neutrinos in gamma ray bursts are very, very far from the S-cube observation. So this kind of sources can be at the moment excluded for explanation as with the events.
But one question, I mean, these models, I mean, can explain, I mean, the high energy cosmic, ultra high energy cosmic rays? So if you have to modify the model so that, I mean, you can fit there, I mean, Can you still explain, I mean, the ultra high energy cosmic rays? No, power gel or...
I don't know, because they have three different models for cosmic ray, for the production of neutrinos in for gamma ray bursts, and they scan the lower parameter and show that in these three cases this kind of source cannot fit the skew data. But,
No, they are not imposing any constraint on the cosmic ray spectrum. So they are using basically information rays and play with that. But
they play with parameters.
Any constraint on the cosmic ray.
So another kind of sources are the active galactic nuclei, but in this case we can see that the AGN can explain only the PB neutrinos, so the very high energetic neutrinos. So in we have also the scenario in which the neutrinos can be explained in the dark matter. In this case we have two scenarios. In the first one, the dark matter is stable and we have the annihilation then produce neutrinos and other standard model particles, for instance. Or we have the case in which the dark matter candidate is not stable, and so it decays in neutrino and other particle. But from an analysis work by Feldstein collaborator, we see that for PV neutrinos, for PV dark matter, the annihilation is negligible with respect to decay. This is principally due to the fact that the event rate of the observation at S cube are proportional in the first case for the case of annihilation, it is proportional to the square of the dark matter density. In the second case, it is also the proportion with the dark matter density. So in literature, it has been argued that we can have an enhancing for the density, for instance, if the dark matter is captured in celestial body like the Sun. But this scenario is already excluded by two papers made by S-cube. Or we can have, in a naively way, an increase of the velocity. So we have the so-called boosted dark matter, and there are a few papers that that made a study in this direction. Or we can have also the decay scenario. So we have a lot of paper which try to explain all the whole neutrino spectrum, or sometimes only the PV neutrinos. And in this case, if one assumes that the dark matter is a gauge singlet under the standard model gauge group, and it is fermionic, we have naturally a simplest operator, which is the renormalizable standard model coupling, the standard model dark matter coupling, which is this one, which is also, it is already studied by Ismaili, Kangas, Epigo. And I just want to spend a few words about this scenario, in which we have a two-body decay, so dark matter decaying in two-body, and there are some channels that produce neutrino as primary neutrinos. So this is the coupling. We have some channel that produce primary neutrinos, and since it is a two-body decay, we have that the primary neutrino flux is peaked around the half of the dark matter mass, and this is in agreement with the two here of the S-cube data, in which we have only two events at 1 pb. So this kind of scenario can explain this equation, but is in not a good agreement if we consider the three here S-cube data, in which we have also a neutrino having a deposit energy of 2 pb. But in this case, with this operator, we have also channel that produce the W boson, W and Z boson, but also Higgs. So we have a very great production of quarks that produce a lot of neutrino as secondary neutrinos. In fact, in this case, Ismail, Kangas, Epigo show that using this operator, they can explain all the whole neutrino spectrum observed by S-cube. But they have to impose that the coupling of this interaction has to be very small, so the order of 10 to minus 30, which is somehow very, which is a, let's say, a natural coupling. But we know that this kind of scenario can be in contrast, could be in contrast with the known astrophysical sources like the supernova remnants, extragalactic supernova remnants, which can explain the low energy neutrino spectrum. So, in our paper, we want to explain the lack of data in the energy range between 300 TB and 1 PB, and also the cutoff in the energy, so we have no observation above 2 PB. And in particular, this plot summarizes our assumption. So for energy, for lower energy, so energy below the 60 TB, the neutrinos are compatible with the background, the standard atmospheric background. In the middle, so for energy, in the energy range between 60 TB up to few hundred TB, we assume that this kind of neutrinos can be explained by some statistical sources. For instance, for extragalactic supernova remnant scenario. And we assume that there exists a very heavy dark matter, which is a decay, electrophilic decay, and in this case, our signal can be explained only the highest part of the neutrino spectrum, so only the three events at the PV energy. So in order to this, we want to consider standard model coupling, standard model dark matter coupling with few characteristics. In particular, we want to have a non-renormalizable coupling in order to have a natural small coupling in the sense that we have suppression of some very high energy scale, for instance, in this case, the Planck scale. We want a direct coupling in neutrino in order to have a primary neutrino flux. We want also a multi-body final state because we have seen that with a two-body decay we have a neutrino spectrum which is very peaked around the half of the dark matter mass. So we want to have a multi-body decay, and also we want to have electrophilic coupling to the standard model because we don't want quark in the final state, since we want to explain only the PV neutrinos and not the low energy neutrinos. So if in the case of one assume that the dark matter is a big singlet under standard model and it is a fermionic particle, in this table it is listed all the possible dark matter standard model coupling. The first one, which is a four-dimensional coupling, which is renormalizable, and the six-dimensional operator. So if we, under our requirements, we have that. Since we want a natural small coupling, so a non-renormalizable coupling, and also a multi-body decay, this coupling is excluded. Also, we want a primary neutrino flux, so in the coupling, we want a coupling to the standard model, which directly coupling to neutrinos, so these two operators are excluded. And we don't want quarks in the final state. So, as we can see, we have only one operator that that satisfy our requirement. So now the question is in turn. So does a symmetry exist in order to have only this operator? We have found two cases. So we can impose two kinds of symmetries. In particular, we can impose an abelian U1 symmetry. And so if one gives to leptons and to the Higgs and to the dark matter particles suitable charge, we can have only this coupling, but this coupling is forbidden. And also we have a particular structure of flavor images which depends on the charge, U1 charge that we assume for leptons and the particle. Or we can use also an abelian symmetry like A4. So in this case, the leptons doublet and leptons singlet are triplet and A4. In this case, we need this model that sees three X doublet, and in this case, the dark matter can be the singlet and A4. And this, in this scenario, we have a particular structure of Fellow indices. In particular, we have all the cycle permutation with different Fellow indices. So I want just to spend a few words with this model, because this, in this model we have also these two kinds of coupling, which in principle can explain the three different lepton masses, but also the three different neutrino masses. But in this case, if one wants to explain the mixing angle between neutrinos, one has to add to this kind of model new states, new particles. For instance, one can add a new particle, which is a SC2 triplet, and also a triplet under A4. In this case, we have another coupling, which gives mass and can explain the mixing angle between neutrinos with a CISO of type 2. But, so in principle, we can parameterize with this model also the masses of neutrino masses and the mixing parameters. But in this case, we have, if one has this kind of particle, we have other coupling with our candidate of dark matter and standard model. So this kind of scenario can spoil our final result. But at the moment we have not studied this kind of coupling, because if one wants to explain both the masses, neutrino masses and neutrino mixing angle, maybe one had to impose some constraint, for instance, for the coupling of energy scale in order to not spoil our final result. So, once we have fixed the symmetry, so fixed the model, we have the differential neutrino flux is composed by two contributions. One which is galactic and one which is extragalactic. So here you can see the different expression for these two different contributions. We have developed the Monte Carlo in order to obtain, to describe the neutrino spectrum obtained by the decay of this kind of a particle. M ka is the mass of dark matter and tau is its lifetime. And rho is the dark matter density in the halo density profile of dark matter. And in our analysis, we have assumed a rather frank white profile for dark matter. But if one change the profile, for instance, consider isothermal profile, the result does not change, dramatically change. So in our analysis, we have considered only this kind of profile. So the total differential neutrino flux here is described by, is composed by two parts, the dark matter flux, neutrino flux, but also the astrophysical neutrino flux. As I already said, this kind of flux can be parameterized by unbroken power law or broken power law. In this kind, we cover all the possible astrophysical scenarios. And then, once we have obtained the differential neutrino flux, one can obtain also the number, the expected number of neutrinos for particular energy beam. And in order to this, we have to know the exposure time. In particular, I want to underline that this analysis is made by considering the three-year data taking of this cube, but it can be generalized also for the four-year data. In particular, one has to know the effective ice cube here as a function of neutrino energy. So, this is our fit. So, in the case of U1 symmetry model, so the blue region is the background, the atmospheric background, conventional and prompt neutrinos. The purple dashed line is the, in this case, is the scenario of unbroken power law. While the green line is the expected signal from our dark matter candidate. So we can see that in order to fit the to obtain the signaling for the energy of 2 PV, we have the best fit is found near for, it's found for a mass, the matter mass of about 5 PV. And in this case, for the case of unbroken power law, the spectral index of the power law is about 3.0. And so you can see here the contour plot for the normalization of the astrophysical flux and the coupling of our standard model, dark matter coupling. So as you can see, there is the coupling is not zero up to 2 sigma, and it is also it is not so unnatural small. It is of the order of 10 to minus 5. So in some sense, we improved the previous result of literature, so for the previous model. Here I show the plot in case of we have again the U1 symmetry, but we now we have a broken power law, which is in, which is somehow related to the, for instance, the extragalactic supernova resources. In this case, the red one, the red line, and also the red region is the, our best fit. The red region is 1 sigma confidence level. And as we can see, we have a different structure for the broken power law. In fact, we have a spectral index. The best fit is found for a spectral index of the order equal to 2.0.
Are you getting the energy cutoff?
Sorry?
Are you fitting the energy cutoff?
No, we assume that the energy cutoff is equal to the one of the extragalactic supernova remnant. So in this case, it's of the order of 100 TB, in particular 125 TB, which is in agreement with the previous work of Chakraborty and Zamir in case of...
have you tried to vary the energy cutoff because the result will change significantly?
Yes, but we here in this scenario assume that this kind of the astrophysical source is the extragalactic supernova remnant. So the cutoff cannot change a lot. So it cannot be as large as, I don't know, 300 TB. So here we fixed the cutoff as the best fit of the extragalactic supernova remnant.
If you enlarge it very much, you go in the other case, in the unbroken power law.
Yes, so if it is very large, so for instance, we have different sources, we can have, for instance, these scenarios.
Yeah, but if you go to 1 PeV, the result will change.
Yes, but what is the astrophysical scenarios in this case? So we check the literature and we assume that in this case we assume that the astrophysical scenario is the extragalactic supernova remnant. So yes, you can change and fit all the data, but then you would explain why the cutoff is 2 PV or different.
Well, you have many models that do that.
For the extra, I mean, really very high energy, I mean, people can assume that the origin of the neutrino events in high school is not necessarily dark matter decay, but for example, it could be neutrino decay. For active galactic nuclei, you can account for PV excess that they see through the decay of some active neutrino to some other neutrino, and for example, ghost of boson. So it doesn't need necessarily to come from dark matter decay. That's
yes, this
problem.
Is just our model, our scenario. Yes, you can have also, so the ice cube can be also explained only by astrophysical sources or only by dark matter decay. So we have different scenarios.
So you have these three ranges, right? And you are accounting for all of them together in the same scheme. What I'm saying is that the highest range could be due to neutrino decay instead of dark matter decay. Neutrinos that come from dark matter. So maybe you could have a hybrid scenario combining the very high energy with one sort of mechanism, the lower with that matter.
But in any case, you need to have the component coming from the supernova remnants. So you have to add the component in any case. I'm just saying that if you try to explain everything with other objects that can go very large energy, then you have the problem to fix the combination of this object with the other one that you expect to be there.
You need to combine.
Yes.
That's why we assume just an electrophilic free body decay, so this kind of carving between the dark matter and standard model, since only to have a signal in the, for high energy neutrinos and not for the for low energy, which we assume that it is dominated by astrophysical sources. So again, from the contour plot, we can see that the carving is different from 0 up to 2 sigma. And again, it is of the order of 10 to minus 5. So, this plot show how the model changes if one assumes the U1 symmetry or the A4 symmetry. So, we can see from the different line that the model provides the same signal at the 2 pV energy. And we have also to extreme case in case we have only the carving with electrons, so we have only one primary neutrinos and two or a couple of electron positive that does not decay in neutrinos, or we have the scenario which we have only tau, and in this scenario we have the most production of neutrinos. So this kind of scenarios covers the all the possible scenario in case of all the scenarios if one change the flavor structure of our carbon. So as we can see, these four scenarios are compatible with themselves. So the result doesn't change if one changes the structure of standard model to the matter. So this is
before you go. But in this case, you assume that this dark matter candidate will concentrate on the center of the galaxy, right?
Yes, we have used the Navarro-Franke-White principle.
Which
so
is
in the galaxy.
And Navarro-Franke-White is rather cuspy. So in a way, you should have a hint from Ice Cube that these events come from the center of the galaxy.
Yes, so we expect that there is a certain level of anisotropy, because we expect that part of event must come from the galactic center. But in any case, we have also an extragalactic contribution. And in case of Navarro-Franke-White, in case of our model, so it depends also on the neutrino spectrum, one can obtain that the galactic contribution is 2/3 of the total flux, while the extragalactic flux is 1/3. So one would expect two events from the galactic center and one event. So
but your dark matter component is rather at high energies, and these events, to the best of my knowledge, don't come from the. I mean, another.
At the end of the talk, I will show you a plot with the direction of these three pV neutrinos, because there is one neutrino that comes from the galactic center and two quite far. But so we need more statistics to exclude or confirm this kind of scenario. But we expect that the flux, that the galactic flux is 2/3 of the total flux.
But I would say that this level of statistics, if you are going to change the profile, taking isothermal for example, a less cuspy profile, I don't think that the analysis is going to change very much, because the statistics is very low.
Yeah,
so we expected that.
But then you change the amount of signal that in your
the direction of the event change if one assume.
Yeah, of course. So in principle, for a forecast, is irrelevant. But for the level of events that you have now, the analysis almost is not going to change very much.
And have you checked if this is consistent also with all the samples of Ice Cube, like for instance the outgoing muon sample, where you have more statistics? But still, I mean, they are not so. I mean, they are more or less consistent. I mean, the data of Ice Cube among themselves. But still, I mean, they are not exactly. I mean, the same shape and so on. So I wonder if you apply this to
to
another sample, I mean, if it's still consistent.
No.
So I have a question about, because you are always talking about the neutrino energies, but Ice Cube doesn't measure neutrino energies, so how do you treat that?
Yes, here...
And the difference can be, the level of 70%.
Yeah, you mean the difference between the velocity energy and the energy of primary neutrinos? Yes.
But not for the PEV yeah, events. Those are
not for the PEV events, but for the others.
For the others, yes.
Yes, in analysis we assume that this, we for simplicity, we assume that these two energies are equal, since also because we have, in principle, one have to perform a Monte Carlo to find the relation between the deposit energy and the neutrino flux, the primary energy of neutrinos. But in this case we have a very low statistics, so we assume that this kind of
You are not taking into account the tracks, for example, because then the difference is huge.
Yes, yes, but for the PV energy, the PV events are only showered.
Yeah, but you are fitting the whole energy range.
Yes, I have a slide on it. So this is the relation between the energy, the deposit energy and the neutrino energy on the primary neutrino energy for different energy regime. So we have also the difference between the interaction, so if it is a track or cascade. And so one expect that if one have a lot of statistics, one can apply this average relation, which is of the order if one uses this number, for instance, in case of 100 CV. The TV, one find that this ratio, the average ratio is of about 75%. So, if one also include this kind of the of uncertainty, our result does not change very dramatically. But in any case, one if the statistic will be increased, so one has also to take into account better take into account this effect. But at the moment we assume that this energy are equal for simplicity. So now let me come to the third part of the talk, which is low energy neutrino excess. So this is this plot summarized for the latest S-cube data. And so as we can see, we have this data shows a 2 sigma excess in this beam, so in the energy range between 60 TV up to 100 TV. If one assume, so with respect to the background, which is the purple line, which is the upper line represents the upper bound of the background, and a astrophysical power law, with having a spectral index of 2. So as we can see, this kind of excess, low energy excess, can be explained if one assumes a steeper astrophysical loop, power law. For instance, in this case we have a power law with a spectral index of 2.6, equal to 2.6. So this is these two plots summarize excess. If one with respect to the sum, so the zero line is the sum of the background, in which we take into account atmospheric and prompt neutrinos and also atmospheric muons, and also an astrophysical component described by e to the minus 2 to the power law with spectral index 2. So here there is the excess in the number of events, and here there is the excess in the neutrino flux. So as we can see from this analysis, this excess is at about 2 sigma. So as I said before, this kind of excess is strongly dependent on which kind of spectral index you have for the fit. So if one assumes an astrophysical power law. But in general, in astrophysical scenarios in which the neutrinos are produced by the hadronic matter acceleration, so for the interaction of proton-proton, proton-to-gamma interaction, in general, the neutrino flux is parametrized by power law, in which the spectral index is given by the sum of two contributions. The first one is the spectral index at the source, so related to the production mechanism. And the other one is related to the propagation effect in the galaxy, for instance, or inside the source, which is depending on the galactic magnetic fields. So in this case, for instance, in the case of cosmic ray, we have that this sum, we know that it is equal to 2.7, but in this case, the cosmic ray are charged particles, so the delta contribution is important. But this is not the case of neutrinos, which are not charged particles, so the propagation effect depending on galactic magnetic fields does not affect the neutrino, so the neutrino flux. And so in this case, in most of astrophysical scenario, astrophysical production mechanism for neutrinos, one would expect that the spectral index is equal to the spectral index at the source, which is smaller than 2.2. And also we have, in literature, there is also this this paper by Murase that show that a multi-messenger approach, so a study which they try to fit the gamma rays observation at Fermilat and neutrino observation at S-cube, they show that the multi-messenger approach provide a similar constraint. So one would expect that in case of neutrinos, the spectral index of power law is as soft as 2.2. So in this case, we can assume that a power law with a spectral index equal to 2 is a good approximation. So if one assumes that this low energy excess has a genuine physical origin, it is of interest to study, so to unveil its nature, so where this kind of excess comes from. And we have two scenarios. Again, we have an astrophysical scenario in which this neutrino comes from the galactic plane, so from the galactic sources, or from the astrophysical extragalactic sources. So we have an isotropic distribution. And or these kind of neutrinos come from the dark matter in case of decay or annihilation. And we perform a study in which we compare the angular distribution of the observed neutrino event with the angular distribution of this that one would expect in this kind of scenario. And due to the log statistic, we assume that just one component, so just one scenario can explain this excess. So we have not considered the case in which two or more scenarios are responsible for this kind of excess. So this is the angular distribution that one would expect in case of astrophysical scenario. This is the galactic distribution, where B is the galactic latitude. We assume that this distribution is uniform, because the law statistics does not affect by if the this kind of distribution is uniform or is peaked near the galactic center. And so we assume that the angular size of the galactic halo, the galactic disk, Big Hall, according to the Fermilat template, we vary the galactic size of the galactic profile between 2 and 4 dB. We have also the extragalactic distribution, in which the probability is uniform, so it is equal to 1. And also we have the two dark matter scenarios in which we have the decay, and again we have annihilation, which is proportional to the square of the density. So in this case, since there is a big difference between in principle, one had to consider different profile because they have different angular distribution for neutrinos come from the galactic disk. And so we consider two different dramatic galactic profiles, which are the Navarro-Frenkel-White and isothermal profile. Since, as we can see from this plot, the isothermal profile, the red line, is uniform and flat, while the Navarro-Frenkel-White is very cusp, so it's peaked near the galactic center, so it predicts that most of neutrinos come from the galactic center. So we, in order to perform this analysis, we use two different non-parametric test statistics, which are the called Novgorod Smirnov test and the Anderson Dalton test. In particular, in the energy beam we consider, so from 60 TV up to 100 TV, TV S-cube has detected 12 events, but we know that 5 events are due to background. So in order to, we know that this kind of events are also affected by the angular uncertainty on the reconstruction of the, in the arrival direction. In particular, this, the angular precision is very bad in case of shower-like topology. So in our analysis, we consider, we perform a Monte Carlo in order to take into account the uncertainty coming from the angular resolution. And also we perform an average on the ground combination, which are 12 events on the binomial factor of 12 events with 5 background events. So in this case we have a range of p-value, which can in our statistical test. And as we can see, the null hypothesis that this kind of test come from, the galactic plane is very misfavored because the p-value is of the order of 10 to minus 2 or 10 to minus 3. The scenario of dark matter annihilation is already excluded by the data. In fact, the p-value is very small, of the order of 10 to minus 4. But the two other cases of isotropic distribution of extragalactic astrophysical source or sources or the dark matter decay scenario is not excluded by the data. So it is of interest to ask this question. So what is the statistic required to exclude the for instance the dark matter decay scenario with respect to the astrophysical distribution? So we to answer to this question, we perform a forecast analysis, and we see that this we have this plot in which show how must be the number of signal events which are required, which is required in order to exclude the dark matter decay scenario with respect to the extragalactic astrophysical scenario. So we have this line which are related to different dark matter profile and different and related to the different test statistics called the Kolmogorov-Smirnov test and the Anderson-Dalton test. So as we can see in this case for the Navarro-Franklin-White, we need 200 events in that particular energy beam in order to exclude with the dark matter scenario with respect to the isotropic one. And in case of isothermal profile, which is flat, we need more events. So this led me to my conclusion. So we, with S-cube, at S-cube we had the first observation of very high energy of extraterrestrial very high energy neutrinos. So it is of interest if this kind of event can be explained. So if the neutrino can be related to the matter problem. In particular, we perform a study in which where the PV neutrinos are due to the decay of a very heavy and electrophilic dark matter, and we have also performed a study in order to unveil the nature, the origin of the, this kind of excess, the low energy excess, the 2 sigma excess, and the energy range between 60 and 100 TV. So this is in both cases, so in the first case and also for the low energy excess, we need more statistics in order to exclude or confirm this kind of scenario. So we need this emphasize the importance of further neutrino telescope like S-cube second generation or Chiantro Kubanet. Thank you for attention.
Thank you, Marco, for this nice presentation. We have already many questions, and maybe some.
So you say that dark matter annihilation is excluded because of the angular distribution, right?
Yes. Yes, because in case of dark matter distribution, in case of dark matter annihilation, we have that the angular distribution is proportional to the square root of the to the square of density.
But that expression is wrong. I mean, the beta function you have, the beta parameter you have there doesn't have to account the clumping, the enhancement factor from cosmological sources. So that beta function, that beta should be something like 6 or 7, around between 5 and 7 orders of magnitude larger than what you have there. So you don't have the cosmological enhancement. So the beta cannot be the same in decay and annihilation.
Okay, beta is related to the interground direction.
That is correct for decay, but not for annihilation. You have to take into account how dark matter clumps as a function of redshift with different masses, and that brings a factor which is something like between 10 to the 5, 10 to the 7, depending on the halo mass function and the profile, and the dependence on the profile we find.
Do you mean the galactic profile, or...?
No, I mean, you have like, this is an enhancement factor similar to the one you have on the right, which is the galactic enhancement. But you have to take into account, this is a extragalactic contribution, so it's a cosmological contribution. So you have to take into account that dark matter has clumped and in different ways, depending on redshift. And when you take that into account, taking into account what is the abundance of halos, what is the concentration and the profile of halos with redshift, that factor is between 10 to the 5 and 10 to the 7. With respect to beta. So that would make the annihilation signal much more isotropic and will make it agree with the data.
Okay, maybe we...
Any comment about flavor ratios?
Yes, in case of the first... this case, yes, we have that... Yes, so we, in case of the Q1 and F4 symmetry, maybe the slide is better. So in this case, we have that in F4, we have the spherical structure of the Kavli is related to the cyber permutation. So we expect that in this case, the flavor ratio, the neutrino flavor ratio at the end is 1:1:1 as the standard flavor ratio. Expected by astrophysical sources, also in case of U1 symmetry. We can have different flavor ratios if one consider, for instance, this extreme case in which we have only electron. Yeah. Which will, at the source we have just electron neutrinos, so at the Earth is very different, the flavor ratio is very different from 1:1:1.
Any other question or comment?
And the decay of dark matter will not produce gammas even at higher order, because there you have constraints very...
Yes, since the dark matter is very heavy, so we have also... we have two different production of gamma. For instance, in this case, if one produce... We have... So, from the decay of dark matter, we have, for instance, this channel. And for instance, we have also the production of white zero, which then decay into gamma. So we have a production, a direct, let's say, production of gamma. And also we can have production of gamma, since we produce also, in this case, this scenario, we have also the production of electrons, which then can produce gamma. And also we have to take into account that there are also the electroweak radiative correction. And so we have the production of gamma. But at the moment we did not perform an analysis in this direction because it is a very involved task, since it is related to the production, to the propagation model. So one has to consider the electroweak radiative correction, the propagation in the galaxy, and so on. We have just checked the total injected electromagnetic energy. So, for instance, the energy of electrons and gamma is compatible with the constraint, the integrated constraint coming from the field. But we does not perform a study in the differential gamma spectrum.
But we have taken into account the radiative correction.
Yes, but in case of neutrinos, the radiative correction is important at two order of magnitude less smaller than the mass of that matter. So in our case, with the mass of 5 pb, so with the mass of 5 pb we expect that the electroweak radial correction is important at the order of 50 TeV, so very far from the ice cube sensibility. So for neutrinos, the electroweak radial correction are most important, but they can be important, could be important for gamma sensors.
So if there are no other questions, we thank Marco again for the seminar.